Okay, thank you so very much. And if you allowed me, I'll take you to my screen. I'm not doing a presentation. I'm gonna just tell you a story and then we will deduct the lessons learned along the way from there. And of course, I'm open to your criticism. I'm open to your perspectives to what I'm doing. And I'm extremely excited. But before my excitement takes me out of context, I want to share a song with you. It's a song that guides me every day in doing what I'm doing. And when you listen to it, I hope when I tell you the story that I have to tell you, you kind of connect. So if you allowed me, and I would like to go to my screen and share this beautiful song with you.
Sometimes alone in the evening, I look outside my window at the shadows in the night. I hear the sounds of distant crying, the darkness multiplying, and weary hearts deny. All I hear is my heartbeat beating like a drum, beating with confusion. All I hear are the voices telling me to go, but I could never run, 'cause in my African dream there's a new tomorrow.
Welcome to my concert. Welcome to my African dream. and this song, every morning when I listen to it, every day when I listen to it, it reminds me of my journey and the mission that I am on. And when I listen to your introduction, your kind introduction, it warms my heart because it tells me that I am on the right track. Sometimes you're so passionate about what you're doing that you sometimes forget whether it's right or wrong. So I want to take you, allow me to take you on a short journey from 2014 when Ernst and I met in Austria. I had been living, well, my name is Beatrice Achaleke. I am the serial author of the Africa for Smart Kids book series and the publisher of Globuntu books. So I was born in Cameroon. I'm a citizen of Austria and I lived in Austria for 20 years. So in 2014, when Ernst and I met, I was invited to speak at TEDx Klagenfurt, and I was supposed to speak on my core topic then, which was diversity and inclusion. And we had a good briefing, and spent time briefing me on how to do my TED talk. And when I got to Klagenfurt, so much was happening in my life at the time, so much was happening. And that very morning when I had to do my talk, I went on stage and I realized that my skirt was kind of torn, not in order. And that was a reflection of how my life was at that moment. And I was pretending that it wasn't happening. So shit was happening in my life, excuse my word, but I really have to use that word because that is what it was. And so I had the feeling that everything that I stood for was crumbling down. So right on stage, I decided to change my talk to shit happens, clean it up and move on. This was a surprise for Ernst because that's not what he briefed me on. I was supposed to talk about the Ubuntu mindset, the Globuntu mindset, but that was what my life was at the time. And I did that talk. That was 2014. So much happened. There were a lot of reactions, positive, negative, and all kinds of things that you can imagine. And I knew that it was time for me to make a radical decision. I think one of the things that I said at the TED Talks, TEDx was, sometimes when things are crumbling, when things are crumbling around you, it is because you have outgrown your space. And sometimes we outgrow our spaces without even realizing that we have. When you outgrow your space and you continue to stay in that space, something happens. Now, let me give you an example. Imagine when you're a baby, you have your baby cot, and now you grow up to become an adult and you're continuously trying to fit yourself in your baby cot. You see how difficult it is. You either have to submit yourself, you either have to reduce yourself, shrink yourself to fit in the bed, stop your own personal growth, or you break out of that bed and take all the risk that it entails, and you go out into the world and find a new bed for yourself. That is what happened in Austria. So in 2015, after my TED talk, you can find it on YouTube, I decided to make a very radical decision to leave Austria to South Africa with a tourist visa, a visiting visa, no work contract, no, no work contract, no bank account, no nothing. I had 1,800 euros in my pocket. That was all of me. But I knew in my mind that I was not going to go back to Austria. I knew I had to find and live my African dream. I had to manifest it. But I even did not know what it was going to be. I did not know what it was going to be. I had some ideas in my head, like those of us who live in Europe, especially after 20 years, you think like you have to go to Africa and fix Africa. You think like you know it all. And so you come here with those ideas and a suitcase full of solutions for Africa. And sometimes we forget to listen to Africa and ask Africa to, we forget to learn about Africa, to relearn Africa, and to allow Africa to guide us, give us a space to grow. So quickly, 2015, end of July, I moved to South Africa. And in 2016, I started a book series called Africa for Smart Kids. That Africa for Smart Kids, that was exactly on the 19th of December. So in 2017, I founded Globuntu Books and published the first two books. In the same year, I was invited coincidentally to submit the two books that I had published to the Gauteng Department of Education. Gauteng is the province where one of the 11 South African provinces where Johannesburg is the capital city. So it is the biggest province in South Africa. So each one of the federal states or the provinces have their own educational program, or they have their own government. So the Department of Education in this city invited me. I was a newcomer. I was not even supposed to be here. But they got wings of these books and they invited me to submit it for approval for schools, which I did. So those were two books. In 2018, I published three other books, and those two first books were approved for schools. And in 2019, the journey continued. By 2019, the series has increased to 12 books written by me. And somehow I always wanted to teach kids to write. And I could see the power, the transformational powers of writing in my own life. You know, I'm writing about Africa, writing about things that I did not know, trying to learn Africa and to use the learning to teach other people so that they know and have a proud sense, grow up with a proud sense of their identity. So in 2019, I decided to launch a new masterclass called Masterclass for Young Writers. And at the same time, I launched another masterclass called Holiday Masterclasses for Black Kids. So the essence of the masterclass had to do with my own identity. Now, let me go one step backward. The reason why things crumbled in Austria when I did my introspective work had to do with the fact that I did not know who I was. I grew up in a system that, in a colonial education system that taught me that Europe was the best place to be. You know, everything that is European is good. We all know these cliches, these stereotypes. So I was in that bubble and trying so hard to fit in Austria, trying to do everything that the environment demanded of me. I could not even defend myself. When you ask me, what has Africa got to offer the world? I mean, I had no answers. I remember there were these kindergarten kids in my kid's kindergarten when they keep telling me, oh, it's so nice that you brown people came to Austria because in Africa you'll die of hunger. You know, there's so many things that you could take from people because you did not know who you are. You don't even know how rich your heritage is. So I was kind of in that bubble. Now, when I came back and I started writing the books and realized how much the process empowered me, how much knowledge I was acquiring, I decided to start that master class and the holiday class for kids. Now, that was in April 2019. Today, we have graduated 14 young authors, 14, five are still in the pipeline. And had the pandemic not come in, we would have graduated more authors by the end of this year. Mind you, two of those 12 authors just won the African Authors Award, and their books have been approved for schools as well. Up until now, a total of the 19 books that I've written and published, the first 11 have been approved for schools. Okay, they're being used in schools in Gauteng. And four adults have published their books, five others are in the pipeline. These adults have been coached and mentored by me to write their own books. Now, the title of my talk, actually why I'm talking, could be the transformational powers of crisis, because right now we're all going through a crisis, the pandemic. Now, behind that crisis lies a huge opportunity. And it is up to us to decide whether we're gonna stay in the crisis and complain and whine and make ourselves victims of the crisis, or if we are able to flip the coin to say what is on the other side. I believe that if we change the way we look at things, the things that we look at change. And I got that quote from Wayne Dyer, and it is so, so powerful when you understand the powers behind those words. You change the perception. What are you looking at right now? What is happening in your life right now? Have you outgrown your space? Is shit happening to you? And this could be a divorce, it could be a workspace that no longer satisfies you, it could be a relationship, it could be an environment that you're living in, it could be just anything. So what does your life look at in this moment, and how are you looking at it? Now the question, then flip the question around, how could you look at it? How could you look at it and see how that thing, what exactly is happening to you could be a source of your entrepreneurship, something that could become your purpose, something that you could do that will not only transform your life, but transform the lives of others. And behind my concept, I have a blueprint principle. It's called T, the principle or the formula is T plus D equal B. T plus D equal B. And it is so simple. Think plus do equal B. So I wanted to become an author. I wanted to become a proud African woman. So what do? I take action. What kind of action do I take? Depends on what kind of thing I want to do. In my case, I wanted to acquire and share knowledge and make this knowledge my business. So again, in less than 4.5 years, we have published 36 books. Globuntu Books has published 36 books. It stemmed out of nothing. I mean, you see me, I'm sweating. It's winter in South Africa. You may be surprised. It's summer in South Africa, so to say. And again, I'm talking about a topic that is very passionate to me. And so it warms my heart when I speak about this. So what I'm here to share with you is just a few lessons that I've learned. Number one, when things are happening in your life, or you're in an environment that does not allow, it's important that you realize that you are not compelled to be in that situation. It's important that you realize that life or the universe or God or whoever you believe in may be telling you, you have outgrown the space. Make a decision. And if you are about to make a decision, this is my number two lesson. The first one is realize when it is time to make a decision, when it is time to move on and make a decision. Number two is make that decision radical. When I moved out of Austria, I made the point that no matter what is going to happen, I was going to stay. I was not going to come back to Austria, because if I came back, I knew I was going to be in my comfort zone. I knew I was going to kind of fit in. But in my mind, I knew it was now time to become who I should be, not who I think others want me to be, not who I think the environment that I live in wants me to be. And again, you can translate this to mean just anything in your life. So when you make that decision, make it radical. I mean, if you're like me, make it radical. don't live in its outside doors. So had I left any side doors, had I left an apartment in Austria or anything, I mean, I had encountered a lot of challenges here. I would have turned around and gone back, but I did not. I gave up everything that I had and I took 2 suitcases. So that forced me to stay here. And when I stayed, the next lesson came, resilience, resilience, resilience. You have to build, train your resilience muscles every day and to focus on that one thing that you want to do. Now, me focusing on writing has allowed me to write and publish 19 books in just 4.5 years. I don't know where it comes from, but it has to do with that resilience, but also with the radicalness, the radical decision that I made, and knowing that this is, I must survive here, I must succeed here, because there's no turning back. And the fourth one is going to be that you see the music I shared with you. I surround myself with a kind of music that reminds me constantly of the journey ahead, of where I want to go. I listen to that kind of music. I completely cut off from people who will remind me of my past, people who will ask me. I had some friends in Austria who asked me, "Don't you miss your kids?" Because I had to leave my kids back in Austria. And I said, that's not a conversation that I want to have. It's not one. So I had to surround myself with the circumstances of the reality that I want to have. And that is listening to a certain kind of music, listening to a certain kind of podcast, hanging out with people who will encourage me, who will support me to achieve what I'm about to achieve or what I'm out for. It's working with children again. Children have a way of showing gratitude. You know, the 12 authors that we have, if you see the transformation that they've gone through, if you see how grateful they are, how that has also transcended into their families, into their schools, I mean, it's just amazing. So that's my lesson number 6. You know, surrounding yourself with the circumstances that lead you to where you want to be. And the 7th one is, investing in someone who has less than you. Investing whatever it is that you're learning along your journey, share it, invest in someone. And when you see the results that you get are the reward. It may not be money immediately. Right at the moment, 19 books don't sell like food. They don't sell like whatever, cosmetic. So it's difficult, but you know, it's a blueprint legacy that is gonna stay. If I pass away today, my books are going to be here. So as you strive to build your businesses, I encourage you to build your business on the premises of something that will graduate to become your blueprint legacy, something that will stay forever. If your business idea is one that is gonna crumble when you're not there, then you would have been spending a whole lot of your energy probably in the right spot. Why in Austria, I was very much in the event industry. I was organizing some of the biggest diversity and inclusion conferences. I had some of the biggest diversity and inclusion experts from the US, from Europe, come to my conferences. Where is that legacy today? I don't even have the website. I can't show anyone that I did that. So that was a legacy that was being built on shady grounds. It had no foundation. It was built on a reaction. I wanted to react to the environment in which I was. And so, but when you get to find a purpose that gives you, that you're passionate about, and which allows you to create that blueprint legacy that can stand with and or without you, then I hope that you have the same passion that I have right now, that you feel the same surge of energy that I have, and that you have the feeling that you can conquer the world, because that is how I feel right now. So some of you talked about education. The books that I write, they are on African history. There is the Africa for Smart Kids book series. If you go on my website, www.globuntubooks.com, you will find all the books there. You'll find also the masterclasses. And my intention is to coach and mentor as many young kids as possible to write and have their books published. Because when a child publishes a book, especially a Black child, publishes a book at a short time, then you realize that it is a lifetime legacy. And when wherever they show up, the conversation changes. It's no longer, oh, poor black kid. Oh, you're an author. Oh, what is your book about? Oh, where can I buy your book? And that opens a lot of doors. Our young authors have been on radio shows. They have been, some of them have been on TV. And this is how changing lives means for me. And well, I hope that that you get contaminated a little bit by my passion and my energy. And I want to say thank you for listening. I could talk to you for the rest of the week, but no, I will stop here and take your questions and your suggestions. I'm interested in partnerships. These books can go to other African countries or even European education system. So I'm here and available for whatever kind of exchange that you may be interested in, or if you have questions. Thank you so much for your attention.
Beatrice, you should be on the TED stage now. I love the energy. You are amazing. I feel like, you know, there's so much power in you. When we spoke back for TEDx Klagenfurt, you had this professional background to be on the TEDx stage. But the energy that you bring here, and it's so clear that what you're doing is the only thing that makes sense for you and nothing else makes sense. And this has brings such a beauty in your journey. And also it's so relatable because I think we all have this thing where we know it makes sense and nothing else makes sense, but we don't have the trust. And I love kind of the rundown where you go like, be radical and attach your vision to music that brings you, that connects you to your ideas and not where you're coming from. I think this is an amazing concept. I really love it. You this broad smile, you really infected me with your energy. And I'm not a low on energy guy, but this is really, that was really beautiful. Thank you so much. Questions, anyone? I'm still enjoying the words that still bounce in my head. I'm opening it up to you guys. Dorothy, how do you think about this when you listen to Beatrice's story?
My question is, I have a question. So you told us that there are children or little babies want to break out of their beds. What do you think keeps adults from breaking out of their child bed? Because I think children are way more creative than older people are. I don't want to front anyone, but I want you to share your comments on this.
You can say older people, because I would never think you're talking about me. So
also,
that is a very interesting question, Dorothy. Thank you for that, and Nikki, thank you for sharing the website, the web link. Listen, Dorothy, I think there are a lot of things that hold us back. First, number one is the fear of judgment. What will people say? What is my environment going to say? The second one is the fear of losses, okay? In Austria, people said, oh, you've been here for 20 years, you have your social environment, you have your clients, you have your children are here, and all the kinds of things. And you attach yourself to that which you have accomplished, and you fail. That kind of bubbles you up and you fail to see what you could accomplish otherwise. So being contented with what has been is one of the reasons that hold adults back. The third one is, I would think, is the comfort. You know, the comfort. In Austria, when my things happened to me, my business ran down and I couldn't get any business. I ran out of cash and couldn't pick up my rent. And so people said, go to social welfare. That is the comfort zone. Quite a lot of people will go to the social welfare. And I was 46. I couldn't picture myself going to the social welfare. That was not my journey. That wouldn't have been a good example for my children. You know, you're bringing up children and you're telling them, if you work hard, you can be your best. And then you're running to the social service. I thought like my grandmother would turn in the grave when she knows that I am going to social welfare. So when people are in that comfort zone where they think that they have alternative, naja, das ist nicht so schlecht. Let's continue noch schlimmer werden, yeah? When people get to that, where they start comparing and say it could be worse, you know, it's still kind of manageable. And then you don't go to the edge. You know, you come to the edge, the tipping point, and you rather tip backwards to what you're used to rather than tip forward to the unknown. And no personal growth doesn't grow within your comfort zone. You grow when you leave your comfort zone. And I think one of, I mean, I could tell you so many reasons, but I'll tell you one last one so that we can move on. One is the fear of success. The fear of success. You fear, you have a dream that is so big that you fear you could fail. So the fear of failing actually stops you from succeeding, from even trying. Okay, I mean, coming to South Africa, I always go back to that story. I could have said, okay, I don't have a visa, I don't have a house, I don't have a work contract. And by the way, Minister Hunsdorfer back at the time, bless his soul, he called me and said, you're not going to anywhere. You don't have a job, you don't have a school for your children, you don't have nothing, you're not going to South Africa. And I had to tell him, Mr. Minister, I'm an Austrian citizen. If they deport me from South Africa, you can come pick me up from the airport. But right now, I'm going to South Africa. So I'll say it's the fear of being judged, the fear of the unknown, being in your comfort zone, thinking that it could be worse, you know, maybe it's better. And I would say the fear of success, the fear of succeeding. Because again, it's so big that you can't even imagine it. I mean, when I started Globuntu Books, I just wanted to write a book. And out of that book became a series. And out of the series came the idea, publish. And also, let me tell you one thing. When the publishing thing came while I was in Austria, I wrote my second book, A Volksfaktor Kulturelle Vielfalt. And my publisher, 7 days before the book launch, I had reserved this Ringsturm, you know, this tall building in Vienna. It's the tallest. We had everything, all the invitations set out. And this guy tells me, you must change this and this and this, or I will not publish. And I said, go to hell. In that moment, I did not know but I knew I was going to launch that book in 7 days. So I had to learn overnight on how to redesign the book and on how to publish. I published that book by myself, and that was the beginning of my publishing career. And so when I came to South Africa and I noticed that I was writing book, it was automatic that I could pick up on that. So quite often when we hear a no, we give so much power to the people that give us a no, instead of thanking them. Because when they say no to me, today when you say no to me, the first thing I think is like, hoorah, how can I do it myself? So a no is a provocation to me. It triggers me to look for a better solution. So sometimes when you meet those no's, you should not sit down and give people powers and make yourself a victim of people's whatever it is. You should rather turn around and say, hey, I'll show you. The best revenge is success. So I guess it's also that is one of the things. Don't take no for a no. Someone is saying no from where they're coming, but it could not be your journey. You know, don't let someone's perception of you become your reality, someone said. I think that's one of the things that adults do. You know, they say, like people say, someone says, I can't do it. And so I think I can do it. Self-doubt. You must break out of self-doubt.
Johan, how do you feel? You're on the brink of a big change in your life. What does this do to you?
Made me think. I mean, wonderful how you framed it in such a very short time, this very important, you know, concepts. And here in The Hague, I'm involved in a school, you know, and it's a weekend school where the focus is on like topics that kids don't learn during the week. So like how to be more empathetic, how to be like team worker. So really on these soft skills. And I looked into some of your books and like how to be a confident girl, really amazing projects and ideas. And in me, in myself, you know, it further reminds me that I have to continue this path I took to become, you know, independent and really pursue my dream in this kind of area of intellectual property. So, you know, I'm always fascinated by how much energy many of you, like people living in Africa, have in terms of not being afraid, you know, like really pursuing what really makes you happy. Here in Europe, failure is often seen as, you know, something very negative, right? And like you should never fail, you should have a job for your whole life, like this kind of standard life journey. But yeah, often you just have to, you know, try and fail up until you don't fail anymore. So thank you for this kind of reminder of this journey.
And I have failed a whole lot. You know, the books that I'm doing, I print them and I realize there's so many typos inside. I throw them away and I do the edit because I knew if I had to wait for an editor to get these books out, I would never have done them. So I print them, I print in small quantities, print 10 copies, and then I look and say, damn, there is a typo. You can't take this out. Throw them away. Go for the next print. Print this time 2 copies and then go through them. That's how I do. I have learned along the way, and I call them my learning curves. They are not failures. Had I not done that, had I not printed, I wouldn't have seen what is in. And I've also tried to not take criticism too personally. When it comes, I look at it and say, okay, is it right or wrong? Is there a space for improvement for me there? Is there a space for personal growth? If it is not, if it is just someone's ego trying to put me down, I say, hey, you go away, you write a book and show me first of all. So I've learned to take the criticism that is good for me, that takes me one step ahead of what I'm about to do. And any other thing, I say, go write your own book. You know, I'm not saying that I'm the someone said that perfection is the ability to perfectly manage your imperfections. So I try every day, every other day to, when I see an imperfection, I try to find a way to perfectly manage it. And I tell myself, I was not born perfect. If I don't try, I can't be perfect. Perfection comes with doing. Every day you become more perfect. You gain a bit of perfection. And by the time when I go into my grave, when I'm in that coffin, and 6 feet below, then I'm perfect because I don't have to strive to do anything anymore. So that is when I am a perfect, that's when I'm a perfect person. Up until then, I fall down and I stand up and I continue and I learn and I go. And so I hope that that can be something for you. Just go for it. People will always have things to say, but hey, the Ubuntu philosophy that guides me says, I am because you are. Some of us have to put stuff outside for some people to have something to talk about, okay? And if you don't put it out, they can't have a sense for existence because they don't have anything to talk about. And if they are talking about you, it means you are active. It tells me that I am productive. It tells me that I'm alive, that I am, you know, making a contribution.
I am because you are. Beautiful. Yes. And Bao has something to add here.
It's such a great segue because I am a firm believer in the whole idea of Ubuntu, the idea that I am because you are. I mean, there's an inherent sense of responsibility enshrined in the philosophy. And one of my goals really at this juncture in my life is to find ways of having that permeate into all aspects of our lives. Use it specifically here on the African continent to create business models that are sustainable and more inclusive. In reality, Ubuntu goes beyond human connectivity and extends to the natural environment. I was raised on this continent. It's very real for me. I found in Western society an individuality that was disconnected or forced me to disconnect from everything else. And I'm just coming back into that. And it's really liberating and freeing. And in light of the COVID-19 epidemic, pandemic now, if we have learned anything as a human race, it has to be that no one gets out of this alone. I think there's a very, very unique reason why COVID-19 is not ravaging the African continent the way we had thought it was going to in March. I hope it's a lesson for humanity. I hope we are taking it and that we are able to grow from it. But I absolutely love your energy, as Nikki had said. And I think that perhaps this whole idea of Ubuntu, this connectivity, whether you're talking about fintech, whether you're talking about education, I think is really, really important. It's time for humanity to just reconnect with itself and use that to move forward. Thank you so much for your presentation. And thank you, Nikki. I'm so glad you took this up.
Talking about Ubuntu, I just let me add this in. Mbayo, I'm sorry for the wrong pronunciation.
It's okay.
I've been working on a concept. I started working on that concept in Austria. It's called Globuntu. So Globuntu is not just the name of my company, it's a concept. It's called a Globuntu Mind Shift System. So it's a concept that is inspired from the Ubuntu philosophy that comes in three modules. Module one is I am. And that module is so extended when you really get to know who you are in all the dimensions, your multiple identities, but also in your spaces of connectivity, and interconnectedness. When you master that, well, it's a process, it's an ongoing process. But when you get into the process, you really see things differently. Now, module two is we are. It's about building relationships. So in module one, you get to know yourself, the different layers of your identity, your being, and your potential and all of that. And in level two, you learn about how to build relationship based on the knowledge that every individual that you come across, whether in business or in social life or wherever, is as complex as you are. And level three is I am because we are. It's the whole philosophy all over. And it gives you principles that allow you to manage mutually beneficial relationships. So I have been on this journey of Ubuntu for quite a long time. And it comes with a lot of affirmations as well. I work with a lot of affirmations. And I'm very happy to tell you that before the end of the year, we're publishing the first Ubuntu book. It's written by one of our South African sisters. We were just talking about we started designing the book today, and it's looking at the concept of Ubuntu out of South Africa across the whole continent. So I'm super, super, super excited for that book. And I would really love to connect because I would really love to get her to kind of share the content in that book once it is published.
Wonderful. I am totally excited and look forward to the publication of that book. I think just in addition, right now, I come from a rural town in Western Zambia. I mean, I come from one of, if not the poorest part of the country. And we are currently looking at how do we bring in people to work with, but work with them to support local businesses, bring in investments, but do it not in an entirely capitalistic way. How do we bring in that Ubuntu twist so that local communities can actually benefit and we are able to share the beauty and the resources that we have with the rest of the world in a sustainable and humane way? So quite exciting. And Nikki, I'm going to catch up with you sometime soon, I promise.
Please do, anytime.
Yeah, and I'll connect you all. So the session is recorded, I'm just editing it, and then we can all revisit it, and you'll all be connected with Beatrice, wherever that journey takes you together. Marcus, how do you feel? How are you feeling about this?
I feel rather good. But before I ask Beatrice a question, I'd like to know, Dorothy or Jonas, who is the older of you two?
I am.
Right. So when you say us, you should say us older people if you're talking to Jonas. Jonas, in your opinion, is Dorothy showing her age when you're having these discussions as Moonshot Pirates? Do you sort of say, well, she's old, she's past it, but us young people, we know the world?
Well, I think she's older than, she seems older than she actually is, because she's so clever and she has so cool views of things. And
okay, I'm going to stop you here, Jonas.
Yeah.
We just don't want you bullshitting your way through into Dorothy's good books.
No way. I'm seriously speaking.
Yeah, I get it. Dorothy, I think you have a fan.
Marco.
I think you have a young admirer.
At least one.
This is what happens to older people, you know? Beatrice, this has been a fascinating story. I'm so sad I missed you in Klagenfurt.
I'll come back to visit.
Yeah, well,
the pandemic is over.
But tell me, where next?
Where next? Where next? The next journey is making sure that I made a commitment at the beginning of the year. I turned 50 in March, and my commitment was to groom 50 young authors before I turned 51. The pandemic sabotaged my commitment, but I'm still definitely going to catch up on that. Out of the books, I'm creating a lot of new resources especially for homeschools. I reckon that sometimes a book can be very intimidating to read. And my intention is to make learning about Africa as exciting as a game of cards. So I am restructuring the contents from the book into a series of flashcards, quizzes, and all kinds of easy to read material, visual material. That's one thing. It's creating multiple sources of income and multiple products from each one of the books that I have. And something, let me add one thing.
Let me stop you. Let me stop you just for a moment.
Okay.
Given the way you've spoken to us so far, I thought you'd be bursting out of the box and doing something completely different. Like, I'm going to be the first over 50-year-old black woman to Mars, or I want to do something really where people would say that's impossible.
I will stop you right there. I will not let you provoke me to go jump to Mars. It's not my passion to go to Mars. So what I'm doing is creating those new material. It's something exciting because it reaches another segment of people that would otherwise not be reached. Just imagine you're driving in a car with your children and you have this set of cards and you're learning while you're driving, or whether you're traveling, or whether you're on a plane, or wherever you are in the evening. It's engaging. So that's I want families to sit together and learn about Africa like a game of cards and have fun with it. And where is my favorite book? Do you see this one? Did you know that we have had up to now 39 female presidents and prime ministers in Africa? Who is talking about that? America just got theirs. They're even still hesitating to swear her in. We have had, and during the pandemic on the 16th of July, what was that? Gabon appointed their first female prime minister. On the 26th of September, Togo appointed their first female prime minister. So when I published this book, they were 37. Now they are 39. And I'm updating this book. So, you know, I don't need to go to Mars to do something impossible. I can do that within the scope of the vision and the mission that I have defined for myself. And I'm quite comfortable with that.
So tell me, why is it that, so I distance myself from other Europeans because of Brexit, of course. But apart from that, why is it that we are not, and I think I'm reasonably well educated in what's going on. How is it that this has come as a revelation to me that you are nearly 50 female leaders out of African nations in the last century? How is it that I'm not aware of that? I mean, Cleopatra was an African, right? And so it started a long time ago, but how is it that we are not always aware of that?
You are British, Marcus.
You should be asking yourself that question, not me. Or you should be reading my books. You know, don't complain.
Your books are out of date. You've just told me they're out of date. They're yesterday's stuff.
And listen, we had our first female prime minister on the continent as far back as 1975. That was before you had Margaret Thatcher. That was in the Central African Republic. Elizabeth,
you're to blame.
So you see, I'm doing something completely impossible. I'm bringing something on the table that you've been around the corner. You don't know. America has been existing for 244 years. They have not had a female president. Okay. So again. I am shifting my paradigm. I'm making my changes. I'm, you know, unleashing information that makes me feel really, really great. And I'm hoping that it will inspire some other people to look at Africa from a different perspective. Because if you ask yourself the question, if we say Africa is poor, now they say Africa is third world, Africa is developing country, now it's emerging economy. The definition keeps changing. And I think it has to do with the fact that Africa is so rich, so complex, that you can't even define it. We know our purchasing power. And if Africa was as poor as everyone else says it is, you know, the Europeans would have long left Africa. The Americans will go. You will not be fighting to be here on the continent. The European countries will not have their military bases stationed in Africa. China will not be wanting to recolonize Africa. We know, just from writing the book, I know what we have. And my mission is to make as many young people, not the leaders, not those up there, the next generation of leaders, to make them aware of these resources as possible, so that they have a proud sense of their African identity. And when they sit on the negotiation table, they sit with their head high and they will not accept any nonsense because they know what they are worth. So that is what is on my plate.
Beatrice, I have a question. I'm following India for a while, and Indian people are very humble people, but they love their country. So generations ago, they started leaving India because it wasn't the place for them to develop their potential. So they went out to the world. And that is changing right now. India is becoming a place that's attractive for Indians. So I see a lot of Indian people going back home. And this means a lot to the intellectual capacity of countries, because when you look to Silicon Valley, all these leading companies are CEO'd by, or a lot of these companies are CEO'd by Indian people. So they go back to their home country because they see that this is the time to come back home. Would you see a momentum like this happening in Africa as well, that people from Africa go back to Africa because they see the biggest potential in fully developing their skills and their ideas is actually home?
It's happening. Ghana has a special program for African Americans wishing to come back home to invest in Ghana. It's one of the first countries in Africa that has that special program and a special invite, which is great. If you look at the agenda 2063 of the African Union, it has the diaspora component. It has a huge, how it's going to be implemented is the question, but the awareness, the consciousness of the fact that Africans in the diaspora need to come back to the continent, and that they need to bring the knowledge, the know-how, there is the financial resources, they have to invest and build businesses here. We are all aware, the awareness is growing more and more. And I think with the challenges that Africans are facing in the US, the racism that and discrimination that they face in Europe, more and more people are beginning to think like me, to say, okay, if I'm not wanted here, you know, if I can only grow to a certain degree here, then I can as well go home. And I think that, but the challenge that most of them are facing is that some of them have dual national, have European nationalities like myself. Some African countries don't accept dual nationalities. That's quite an issue. And in some countries, taxation for people coming in, you know, people from the diaspora coming in to do business, it's still quite something that needs to be looked into. The regulations, the startup regulations are still somehow not very friendly, but nonetheless, so much is happening. And I could have gone back to Cameroon, but I knew if I went to Cameroon, I wouldn't have been able to do what I did. I mean, you can stay abroad for 20 years and you come back with two suitcases and 1,800 to your country. I mean, you'll be a disgrace to your family, complete failure. But when you turn around and you go to another country where you come and people see your expertise, or where you can establish that expertise, it does really, really help. And I'm hoping that many people will see, will realize that, you know, that second option of saying, if going back to your country of origin is has some limitations, you can divert and go to another African country. Yes, you will still have some challenges, but hey, at the end of the day, the possibilities that you have here are much, much bigger, than those that you have in Europe. The competitivity that you have in Europe and in America, you don't have it here. And let's be honest, when you look at Black people in Europe and in America, in which area are they succeeding? You can work in the area of integration, anti-racism management, you can do diversity and inclusion, or you can be in healthcare or the care of elderly people. those are the only areas where you can excel, where you don't even have the possibility to have a promotion, to have a salary increase, or you know, to grow personally. It's care jobs. And I think those of them who are beginning to realize, I have had enough of this, I am more, I can do better, they're beginning to realize that the future is in Africa. Let's not forget that Africa is the second largest continent in the world. It is the youngest continent in the world, and it has limitless resources, which have, you know, which are part of her tragedy. But we have all of that on the continent. And anyone who is foresighted will see that sooner or later. And I'm hoping that there will be, you know, some massive shifts of people moving to the continent.
And two people here in the room have developed technology to repopulate the desert.
I have a question.
Yes.
Yes, can you hear me? Yeah. First of all, congratulations to this great way and to the great project. I would be interested to know a little bit more about the business model behind this book situation. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit, a few figures to it?
The figures, I can tell you the figures in terms of the books that are published. Mm-hmm. The market still has to be developed. My intention was to create product, not to create one book, but to create a product and then to go to the market, because this is a one woman show. Let me put it that way. It's a one woman business. She does the writing, she does the masterclasses, she does the designing. And so the marketing aspect is still kind of lacking behind. But that's something that I plan to focus on 2020. And I hope that the numbers will kind of come in. At the moment, our main buyer is the Gauteng Department of Education. But something that I'm also trying to do to expand the market is build Globuntu books to have a model like Amazon. I want to be the African Amazon, where we publish books on African identity, on African history, African culture in different African languages, where we also have digital books. Mm. So at the moment, we're looking into building that structure that allows for the physical books to be offered as digital books as well. To get those African languages, books in those African languages in. The perspective is there, the possibility is there. Mm-hmm. We're still building the cornerstone. And again, I don't want to release any numbers. I can tell you we have 39 books published in 3.5 years. And in terms of sales, that's something that we're working on, because the market is huge in terms of education. This kind of books, they're not the books that you find in normal public schools or even private schools. And if we write more of them, then we definitely have an opportunity, not just on the continent, but also in the diaspora, with African parents who are in the diaspora. And those companies that are doing business in Africa, you know, it gives them the need to, some of this book can really be very beneficial to their employees or their, you know, the expatriates. And for them to get to know Africa beyond what, you know, what they normally think they know.